Welcome to Let's Talk Humanitarian, Parlons Humanitaire, enriching conversations with humanitarian workers and humanitarian leaders to open eyes, heart, and mind. This is a program by Kalyu Institute, your online center for humanitarian studies, where humanitarians train humanitarians. My name is Amélie Yang-Griffes, and I'm really delighted to be your host for this conversation today with Camilo Valderrama and Ana Calvo. Camilo, Ana, welcome to our program. Thank you for your time.
Thank you for the invitation.
Thank you very much for having us here.
Yes, so that's going to be a really, really exciting conversation. And so let me introduce you a little before we start. So Camilo and Ana, you're a couple, and you're going to tell us a little more about that, because that's a fascinating journey. No, you study, you both doctors, you specialize through master degrees in public community health from the Hebrew University. You studied for doctorates in Sussex and Oxford, and your passion is health rights. No, how you can support population to access their health rights and to rebalance these inequity situations when there's poverty, when there's war in Latin America, in Africa, in Asia, and in Europe, and where people cannot access health properly. So you have developed the humanitarian health sector in refugee and displaced camps, worked on reference systems within the health sector, with the host populations and in active conflict contexts like Syria, Colombia, Iraq, and the Democratic Republic of Congo. You have worked at natural disasters programs and direct services to the population in Colombia, Spain, Pakistan, Indonesia, and Burma. In post-crisis situations, you've been participating in the rehabilitation of the health systems in peace processes in Nicaragua, Liberia, Sierra Leone, Mozambique, and Kosovo. Simultaneously, you've promoted participatory action research in all the organizations where you have been working, and you've always remained actively academically as lecturers in humanitarian health, community health, and global public health in Colombia. So there's so much to say. I mean, so many years you've been working in the field of public health with different hats. Camilo, you're the director of the Health Syria program, and you're in charge of developing and managing these regional strategies with donors and agencies for the cross-border Syria response. And Ana, so you will tell us more about that. And Ana, you have a really interesting role. You are coordinating and developing the technical aspects of the COVID response within Syria borders. Yeah. So thank you for this time and all what you're going to share with us. So can we start just with this aspect of this journey that can be very inspiring actually for many of our audience who is listening to us. So you were telling me since 1994, You are together as a couple and working together. So can you tell us how you've made it possible?
You can start. Huh? No? Well, basically, we started our humanitarian work like a couple, basically. Our first humanitarian experience was, for both of us, was as a couple. And it started in Mozambique in 1994, 1995. And since then, we have continued on the same area of work, interrupting for some periods of time to study, to do our master's. No, our master was before, to do our PhDs, and then come back to work. Sometimes we work together, but most of the time we have worked in separate, in different places. Here now in the Syria response, it has like the first time that have been together for at least 2 or 3 years. So that's a very exceptional in our long journey in humanitarian work. Yeah.
Okay. So, but I feel you are united not only by love, but this passion, no, for people's rights and for people's access to health.
Yeah, from different perspectives, though. My route on the medical issues from Spain when I did the medicine in Pamplona University was basically working there in a hospital that was close to the university faculty. And then we were working with, at that moment, we were starting to work with minority groups, many of the nomad population in Spain, and many different populations there, including Romani and Gypsies that cross or leave different parts of the country in different seasons. We were working there with other type of people that were in special needs. And from there, I keep all my clinical sort of orientation. I'm convinced, and maybe this is part of the issue that is interesting, if someone is doing this journey with the partners, those that are listening to us, is that you can have different skills and different, totally practice different. So yeah. I try to do more. My clinical work, I have been working as medical doctor in many refugee settings, in many camps, for IDPs, doing medical campaigns. And till now, I really prefer more to be very close, tied to the practitioners, like now in the COVID, although it's a remote response, and I'm consulting for GIZ. Because there is no any other way of working in any health issue right now because of the remote conditions for the cross-border
yes.
Syria, which Camilo may explain a bit better about that, plus the issue that the COVID adds an yes. additional burden of social distancing. So before we were separate from the direct right holders to which we are delivering services, because of the conditions of the war in Syria, but now also separate from the practitioners that I was in touch and working with them for the last 3 years, hand to hand in the organizations in the cross border, like in Turkey, Syria, Lebanon, Iraq. So it's very interesting. It's a double burden of social distancing, one from the war and COVID. So we can talk about that in
yes. After we really want to dive inside what is the I mean, I'm really curious to hear how you were working COVID and in the conflict context that you are. So for the moment, you are in Gaziantep, in Turkey.
Yeah.
And so you can you continue maybe a little, Anna, with what you've just said about your role with GIZ, how you're dealing with the COVID situation. And then I will ask Camilo, what is his role from Gaziantep? What he's doing?
Well, basically, the cross-border response was sort of stormed by COVID. And last year, by this time, we already all in a complete a sense of alert because the confinement has started in Turkey, and the assessments from the Global Task Force of COVID and the partners hand-to-hand with OCHA, here the humanitarian coordinator, they were all together trying to look what was the best response, because clearly there were four factors that were there because of the war inside Syrian cross-border opposition areas, which is the northwest of Syria and the east of Syria. The health system basically do not have a unique or integrative governance. The health sector, it is built between international NGOs, local NGOs, cross-border, diaspora-based, or funded by European Union funds, or FDA by USAID. So Japanese, all these donors has these piecemeals of organization. And at that moment, last year, as you and many other people know, the conflict has been fragmented much more, the area. So on top of that, the area which we were working is itself buffered by the Turkish military occupation areas, and separated from the borders. They cannot move out of the borders of Italy. So you have a self-contained population that was, this is the first say, with a very weak and fragile health system and a fragmented sector, but with a medical body of nurses and doctors that has been really decreased by the war, that has been in a very difficult situations delivering services. And now they have to be exposed to the risk of maybe those crossing the borders, which were very selective, military people, state and or non-state actors that cross into Idlib, could also bring the risk of increasing the COVID incident. So this situation really exposed the community there. Therefore, we were trying to support the needs of the Global Task Force in three main areas. The case management of COVID with a specific center, which I will talk about that a bit later, very important. Isolation centers initially ended up to be treatment centers. The second leg was all the diagnosis capacity on surveillance laboratory for both COVID and associated health infections, which were at risk for the patients of COVID. And the third leg was all the immense need for mental health and psychosocial support, because of the additional burden on health coping behavior and health seeking by the people that were at risk of being with COVID and in isolation. So,
Anna, and then Camilo, to ask you, what is your role? Can you start by telling in your role as what is this Health Syria program?
So for the Syria response, basically my role, the program we have is a program that started that is supporting the resilience of the health sector inside Syria, basically by supporting the local health authorities, opposition local health authorities, and through capacity development activities and stabilizing their livelihoods with salaries and incomes. So that's basically what we have been supporting from the start. So basically, we were working on the strengthening of the local governance in health. However, this changed as the situation got much more complex with the coming in of very extremist groups who took over the northwest part of Syria, which created a high political risk for different actors and donors. And so now basically we shifted to support service delivery at the local level. Primary healthcare centers, specialized centers, and secondary health facilities.
Okay, thank you very much. And when we were discussing to prepare this interview, you were mentioning cross-border Syria. And for those of us who are not that familiar directly with the Syria context, can you explain us what is the terminology we should use?
Okay, yeah. Basically, what has happened, you know, Syria has been a very complex conflict because this started as a democratic revolution by the people, but was taken as an opportunity by different groups, by extremist groups, by several governments that are in the Security Council, some supporting the moderate opposition, some supporting the government, the regime, and then so in addition to that, there's the Kurd factions looking into more autonomy within Syria. So the country became fragmented, and basically one part of the country now is controlled by the regime, that's government control areas. Another part of the country is controlled by, the Kurdish authorities, and the other part of the country is controlled by the opposition, factions. Actors. So basically, where we work at this moment is in the opposition control areas, cross border, one of the that hosts around 4 million people. And that's what we call the northwest part of Syria, which is now the only one that's, or one of the few areas that is controlled by the opposition forces. So when we say cross-border, is we kind of speak of support to whole Syria, but a specific part of Syria that's called the northwest area of Syria.
Okay, thank you for this explanation. What do you see? I mean, it's like more than 8 years that you've been working on the issue, the response to Syrian refugees, no?
Yes.
Yes. So what would you say? I mean, it's a broad question, but what have you seen in these 8 years happening? What are the big lessons, the big bullet points? I mean, if I may use this expression, to main learnings that you can extract from this 8 years experience?
Yeah, I mean, this is a very particular situation. The Syria conflict, as I say, is very particular because of these political developments and how the country has been fragmented. So at this point, if you speak of a health sector, in Syria, for a health system, we have four health systems. You have the health system of the regime areas, we have the health system of the opposition control areas, and you have the free health, and the health system in the Kurdish control areas, to say it some way. So it's very complex, the situation, and very unique. So it's very difficult to come up with lessons for other conflicts. But what we can say, and also the challenges, no? So the work had to be done from four different hubs at the beginning. One hub that was looking into issues that were happening in the southern part of Syria, controlled by the opposition. Another hub that was looking at what's happening on the northwest part of Syria, controlled also by the opposition. Then another hub working on the Kurdish control areas, and another working group in the regime control areas. So that has been a big challenge, or always was a big challenge in terms of coordination and collaboration, given the different factions in conflict. So, but if I want to speak of something, that one of the major challenges that was faced, that has been faced again, very unique, and has been the issue of securing the right to health of the people in South Syria, because it's the first time in a conflict situation where the health sector has and continues to be deliberately attacked as part of a war strategy of the Syrian regime. And from March 2011 to today, they have been they have been corroborated at least close to 600 attacks in 350 separate facilities, with more than 900 health workers killed. And that is a strategy too, and that explains much why the big drainage of human resources, the health human resources that left the country because of security reasons and other reasons. Second, explains the big waves of displacement and refugees, because that as a strategy, if you finish an area, the stop services in a whole area, a whole province, then people leave, because where do I take my children for health? For health service delivery. So that has been a major challenge. Now, what can we say that has been an achievement in this sense has been to maintain a health system running in spite of all, yeah, during those 4 or 5 years. with huge efforts and in a cross-border remote management situation. So that has been really, really a big achievement from all the stakeholders working in health in Northern Syria. Lessons learned from our side, we started to supporting the strengthening of the local health authorities, thinking on a long-term, let's say medium-term development, where we could stabilize the health systems working for the building blocks that we all know. However, this situation really changed after, as due to the dynamics of the conflict, and where not more support was being able to be provided to these authorities. But although, in spite of that, they continue to work themselves in trying to coordinate internally the work.
Wow. Thank you, Camilo. Anna, would you like to add something about what would be your lessons learned from these 8 years?
Well, to those that are listening to us, I really want to say that what Camilo say is one of the phase which tremendously impact the other face of the coin on health, which is the provision of services. So what doctors like me, nurses, technicians, radiologists, lab staff, drivers of ambulance have to do when the situation that Camilo is portraying of initially a war that was till 2015, more or less winning in order to the path to democracy and the general diversity on the whole minorities in Syria together. And after 2015, when the allied opposition, the allies from the government of Syria win the war, basically win the territories, rescue their territories, and reduce bit by bit the areas where all the doctors, nurses, and lab technicians were working. So one of the, this evolution is how the medical mission has been challenged in order to keep the right of their own people, because they didn't have us inside as a neutral actors to help them. So this is with exceptions, like in probably in the border with Burma and Thailand or Sri Lanka in some areas, and in another few other countries currently now, maybe Pakistan and Afghanistan, where the medical mission inside have to practice neutrality and independence in the delivery of services. Yeah. And so, as you can see, all these doctors that were prepared for mostly a private sector, the public sector was only 40% and in the non very prosperous areas. So these doctors that were traumatologists, ENT doctors, surgeons, ended up from one day to the other to basically open in their own clinics that they have before, or buildings that were from the government and were left behind by the civil servants when they went to Damascus, open clinics. They started to manage and organize a self-tailored system of clinics connected to a referral system and supported, of course, by funds from international donors, that is to say. This is one important thing. So in terms of the medical services, we have many things to thanks, many things to excuse, and many things to follow in the future. And in parallel to this medical body that was ready to serve the people, then these white helmets, which was an emergency system to just rescue. It was a rescue system to rescue people that was injured by bombings and decrease the time between the injury and the arrival to the hospital. So we have these two amazing actions that has been telling us a lot about protocols in war zones, guidelines and standard operating procedures that safeguard also neutrality and independence as much as they could. This is for the moment with the remote support from outsiders like me and other people. Although I have the sad and rewarding experience to open SATARICAM as a medical delegate for the UNSCR, which was a total different experience from the Syrian refugees accessing services as it is in Turkey or in Iraq or in Lebanon, which we can talk about that later.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much. It's such a complex system and complex situation. And what I'm hearing from you, yes, in quite unusual. I mean, something never seen, no? And what I'm hearing also from you is, and here the importance now of having our standards ready and training our people on the standards, because when we get on in situations like that, that's the safety jacket, no? The rescue jacket that we have, the life jacket, sorry, that we have so that we can navigate in such an environment, no? Wow, very interesting. And you, Camilo, you've been heading the health cluster for some time for WHO. Mm-hmm. And so already, I mean, being a cluster lead, it's a tough job, no? With many agencies, everyone with the agenda. And when I'm hearing the complexity at political level, at human level, at the geographical level, and the pandemic level, if we add it. How was it? Is it the fact that the context is so complex? Is it a unifying factor for the agencies and the humanitarian actors? Or is it just an extra layer of difficulties to manage as a lead cluster?
Just to add a little bit to the lessons learned. One of the lessons learned, I would say, is that the planning ceiling, usually in emergencies, you work planning in short term, 6 months, and then let's see what happens, yeah. And then another 6 months or 1 year. And the problem with that in a situation like the one in Syria, where we are already in the year number 10 of the conflict, is that you cannot plan on the medium term to establish what was mentioned before, the issue of standards and all these things. So one lesson here is, when you have an emergency, you have to gamble, I would say, and say, plan with the assumption that this will be a long-term ride and that you need to really strengthen the health systems in all its components. And one of them is service delivery. So going to the issue of the cluster, when I arrived, the situation was very particular. As you know, in 2014, the conflict started in 2011, and only until 2014 the UN resolution came out with the UN Security Council came out with the cross-border resolution that allowed the UN to work cross-border from Turkey or from Jordan, etc. So as you know, in the humanitarian architecture, the cluster is established when you have that the possibility to work inside the country. So at that point, because of all these political reasons, there was not a health cluster, it was what they call a health working group that basically was led by NGOs. So when the resolution was approved, I arrived, and my task was to establish the health cluster as such with all its procedures, et cetera, et cetera. But there has work that had been done before. So we had a certain number of partners most of the partners that were in the health cluster were newly established Syrian NGOs and a very few international NGOs. So basically from the diaspora. So basically it was organizations that were very new into the humanitarian system and didn't know very much about it. So the first part, the first task was to really put them into the what it means to the health cluster within the humanitarian system. That was the first task. Then The as you know, the main task of the health cluster is coordination. The main task. So basically, how can we do coordination? You have to establish an information system that allows you to identify where are the gaps in terms of services, where are the gaps in terms of resources, et cetera, et cetera. And we have these tools that we all know, that's the HIRAMs, that's the 4 W's. So that didn't exist. We have to start with that. And in a conflict area is very complex because given the security situation where you had the bombing of hospitals, of health facilities, no one wanted to provide data that could affect the security of the people inside Syria. So how do you establish gaps in services if you don't have the right information? That was very complex at the beginning. But in terms of the emergency response, the coordination was very good because we had internal coordination with the health authorities and external coordination with the cluster members. So when the massive attack of hospitals started to happen in one of the provinces, the coordination mechanism 724 was established with WhatsApp groups inside Syria, WhatsApp groups outside Syria. And inside Syria, the focal point was the health director, and he informed the health cluster, which was a health focal point, on what were the needs, real time, of equipment, oxygen, name it, in hospitals that were receiving patients from other places being attacked in the province. So that worked very well, and so I think that was the first I would say very clear coordination response that we have. Secondly, then the second point was the governance of the health cluster. Usually in a normal health cluster, you have the lead, who is the lead agency is WHO, and the health coordinator is also supported by WHO, and you have a colleague from an NGO or from the government even.
Yeah.
There was no government here. So initially we had two, and at some point it was only international agencies that were doing that role. And most of the partners were Syrians. So basically we decided to establish a Syrian colleague position. First, in terms of capacity development, in terms of coordination within the humanitarian system. And second, to represent very well the interests of the Syrian communities inside and outside. And that was the idea, bringing more Syrian communities. And that also, I think, worked very well, at least the first or second year. So those were the two big things that we can say. Then the third point, and as a lesson learned, is the issue of, once you had the information, we were able to establish that the services were really fragmented. So one NGO was providing services in reproductive health, but no primary healthcare consultations. Other ones were only doing that aspect. So we started to work together with the cluster in standardized type of services that were provided by each level. We established committees that developed all the technical standards for the essential package of services. And that was a first, let's say, timid development on strengthening the service delivery block of the health system. So on and so forth. Then was the health information system, something that there was basically you had the 4 W's and the HIRAMs, but you didn't have other information that can provide you data for action in terms of morbidity and mortality, for example, except for a surveillance system that already had been established with the support of the CDC and others that worked very, very well. So that was the other level, the building block that until now is developing. There's already a health information system and besides this surveillance system and the other sources of information. And that allows to inform better the response.
Wow, amazing. Again, the complexity and what I'm hearing, interesting role also, because sometimes the cluster, we imagine as a coordination, more meeting, and we can see things. But here, what I hear, it's been so key to the response. Also integrating non-traditional actors or new actors to Imagine Aid, training them. And then I hear that you ended up with a health information system and health surveillance system that were not in place. So congratulations. And
surveillance in place before, because I don't know if for the people, perhaps they remember, there was a polio outbreak in Syria in the south of the country in 2013. But that time, there was a surveillance system that had been established by the opposition groups, one's called the, and they had with the support, technical support from the CDC and WHO and all this.
Okay.
These guys had a very strong surveillance system.
Okay. So you've been retaking that and building on that.
Yeah.
Excellent. Thank you so much for respect. And Anna, you know, I really wanted to ask you about the COVID in cross-border Syria. We're just wondering, how does it look like? How is COVID impacting and how are people coping? No, well, how does it look like? You know, we hear, people who are listening to us are actually from all over the world. And so just how is it happening there and how people are coping? Are they confining? Is it possible to confine in the context where they are living? You explained to us at the beginning this triple or quadruple distancing, no, that you're having from the field and for protection and everything. So can you tell us what does it look like COVID right now and in this context?
I imagine that some of the people that are now taking the course in Kalua and those that are listening has the experience of other infections in their field, like Ebola or H1N1 or the outbreaks. The point with this outbreak, right, is the outbreak itself constitute another social condition. So it creates a social condition. The other outbreaks comes from social conditionings, whatever is in poverty or underserved services is a context or war, which create the conditions for the outbreak. But here, the outbreak itself create another social condition, which you have to really tackle from the beginning. OCHA have the response to the pandemic in a big aspect of securing access, humanitarian space, securing borders, that all the NFIs and all the pharmaceuticals and equipment that are needed cross the border through the all UNMNN system, all that was secured by OCHA. But the cluster structured the 8 pillars strategy from the global into cross-border. And out of the 8 pillars, the GIZ supported 3 directly with funds, which is the surveillance and laboratories. So 2 laboratories in the area in Northwest Syria with capacity building for the person that are delivering these services through 4 NGOs and the MSPSS program that was integrated to all the partners. One thing that happened with the response, I'm going to speak about the impact. During the 6-month emergency, which was the response in most of the funds, and now there are sustaining responses by different UN agencies and different NGO work inside, we have the opportunity to tackle the first and prevent the second wave. So basically, when the first case in July 27 was marking the outbreak inside Syria, till December, this first wave, okay, was really tackled with services. And it was in spite of all the obstacles. For instance, the program started in more or less in all the organizations in April or May, but all the logistics that has to do with the cross border in a war of 10 years are completely difficult to overcome. So you have to double check all the equipment. They have to be tracking with the satellite systems. They have to be clear in terms of quality. They have to pass the border and they have to allocate it inside of the area. So they have to cross, not only cross border, but frontline borders.
Yeah.
So all these, okay, extended the process for 3 months. The other problem is the capacity building. So then you have to train. More or less 40% of the human resources now, doctors and nurses, has been trained in war Syria, has been trained by nurses schools, midwife schools, medical schools, tailored by their people living in Idlib and in Aleppo through their own needs in small institutes, and they have been trained with international tutors by telemedicine with the support of many international. So imagine you have this. So then you have to scale up their skills to for them to drop the regular primary healthcare or surgical and dedicate for these 3 months to the COVID. Then the third point is provide the facilities. So approximately we support. So by the end of December, we really cover approximately 8,000 cases that has been diagnosed, approximately 60,000 tests in a population of 2.5 million displaced and the rest locals. And we really, I believe we averted the second wave. What is now the situation is that the COVID cases has decreased in a daily basis. And what I think we will face, of course, is the second phase, which will be delayed, and it will be on the hands of keeping all the hygienic risk communication, prevention activities, and testing and tracing, which are the four pillars that will allow us not to face another outbreak of or the second phase of the COVID. Of course, that will depend on how the war unfold, how the negotiations, I don't know if you know, but today and tomorrow, there is the Brussels conference on Syria. It will be very important to know if the negotiations will be on the way, and the doctors and the nurses and all the staff and laboratory personnel that were trained to keep really an eye on the tracing, testing, and preventing with hygiene.
Thank you so much, Anna. Fascinating work and really, really inspiring and admiring work you all doing. And you're talking about the Brussels conference, and that links to let's say this last question regarding the context of Syria. This Brussels conference, I mean, what are the expectations, and it links to the questions. I mean, what do you see? How do you see the future, especially of the refugees? Do you see them staying in Turkey, resettling in another country, in a third country, or going back to Syria one day? I would say the dream, but beyond the dream, what do you see is possible?
Yeah, at this point, the situation is very uncertain. First of all, for the return, it will take a long time for the people to return to Syria. Because there's no prospect at the moment of a negotiated settlement, of reconciliation, or a lasting stabilization. There's no prospect up to now. And on the other hand, Syria faces enormous challenges. Well, beyond rebuilding the infrastructure, there's also all these issues about the need to assist the restart of the economy. The economic situation of Syria now is one of the worst that you can imagine. There's also the need to stabilize the currency. The devaluation in the last months has been enormous, and the acquisition capacity of the Syrian population at the regime area is in general, but most in the regime area is very limited. The issue to renew all the public services. I told you, more than 350 facilities have been attacked and destroyed. So they need rehabilitation or reconstruction. And that is huge amount of money. People speak about $170 billion to rebuild this the country again. And if on top of that you add a law, that a recent law that came that basically has a practical effect that the refugees have lost the right to their houses that they were living before they left, then it will take a long time. Well, there's not a political solution to this, and well, there's not a change of a regime, a political change, the North are very clear that they are not going to support any reconstruction. So return would be a long-term issue, and probably it will become, as it has happened in other situations, our conflicts, the warehousing of refugees that will spend years and years waiting to go back to their countries of origin. So the perspective is not very, very optimistic in terms of return. Now,
and excuse me, when you speak to the refugees, what do they tell you?
Well, that's a good question, because I mean, here where we are, that is in Gaziantep, you have at least 500,000 refugees. Most of them are seeking to be integrated into the Turkish society and Turkey in that sense has done a very good job. It has provided the nationality to hundreds of thousands of Syrians up to now. However, to the highly qualified, so there are many that basically, and as the time passes by, the more you lose the roots and you and your family to the country of origin. So I don't have a study that I can say this in X percent of the stay in Syria. I don't have them, so I cannot provide you that information at this moment. But what we know from other experiences is that the longer the time of return takes, the less number of refugees want to return to the country. Even what I told you before, it will take, so they're looking for resettlement in our countries, that has happened, or they are basically fleeing the country to try to look another place of refuge.
Thank you. Anna, anything you would like to add on to that? Or?
Again, the other side of the coin. Yes, imagine this percentage of people return. Imagine just, there is 7 million refugees outside, in between Iraq, Lebanon, Jordan, Turkey, Greece, Sudan, Egypt, name it. I'm not speaking about the resettle already in Europe or in another countries. So whatever is the percentage of those that want to return, there is approximately 7% counted, okay, in a very small sample surveys of people with disability. So what you are returning also, okay, is health impaired people. Which will have families that will need to dedicate one person of the family, if they are complete families, as a home caterers. Then you have two persons in a family, let's say traditional family of 7 or 8, that are affected by the war disabilities, which the ones that has been counted. Think about the orphans that probably they will return to foster homes because their families will bring them from Gaziantep. I engage with medical support and voluntary in orphanage here. There are kids that do have a replacement of the hip that has to be replaced 10 years later. They lost one eye, they lost the ears, they lost their hand, they don't have prosthetic support. So this is what you have to think about returning. People return with health needs and with needs of a healthcare system that should be secure in the return process. Mm. So then for that, we need medical doctors, nurses that has been trained. And that's why I always say in this type of program, whatever you do, do it the best you can, because if they remain, they will be able to adapt, tailor, and participate in the design of the health system, health sector provision, and probably in the health system policies. But this is what you have. And for that, you need to think about budget. So how much will be an insurance, a war insurance system that we doctors can receive these patients and serve them as they need and as they deserve, that restore their dignity and that allow them, okay, to have a productive life within their boundaries of possibilities. So all these things is a health problem. Yeah. And a health problem that has been and need to be taken from the reparation side. And so how many policies of health reparation has been seen in the past? Although we have fantastic humanitarian laws, fantastic policies of return, always the health reparation is something that takes a lot of effort from the donors and a lot of work from the medical mission.
Mm. Thank you so much, Camilo and Ana, for sharing your passion and your professionalism. It was very enlightening, professionally wise, but also very inspiring and very moving to know from first hand what is the plight of the people affected by the Syrian conflict. To close the interview now, I would like, we started with a personal question because I love your story and your journey. And now a couple of questions also to, first, have you ever dreamed of or considered doing something else than what you're doing?
Well, I'll tell you from my side. Well, my experience with this crisis has led me to look at differently the way to move forward. And I mean, yes, I consider doing something that's different. Basically, I want to go into focusing on producing human rights documentaries. The experience has shown me that the work done in providing assistance in humanitarian crisis like the one in Syria needs to be coupled with issues about accountability and rights advocacy. So that's where I want to focus on the.
Okay, great. And you, Ana?
No, I will keep on working on what I know to do. I'm a medical person working on humanitarian situation. What I will really try to reinforce is all the issue about delivery quality of services, research, and definitely academic teaching. I wish if Syria opens up the negotiation and all these doctors and nurses that has been trained by us remotely by telemedicine, they were students that they didn't finish medicine and they engage in all these extensive courses, midwives, that we can really provide them in 10 years time or 5 years time with their final degree accredited by the Syria government and by the regional of academic excellence. That will be for me my dream. Yes.
Okay. Awesome. And as a final word, what would you be your piece of advice for CALU students who are, and many of them, I mean, the majority of them, professionals already engaged, but who want to upscale a little the humanitarian career or deepen the knowledge in humanitarian aid? What would be your one piece of advice based on your experience?
Well, me, I have said that to some of my students for the master, do not replicate humanitarian colonialism. The the fact that we are privileged in having the knowledge doesn't mean that we are privileged on taking decisions. These decisions, even about the medical program of COVID, it needs to be consensually done, technically standardized, and on top of that, guaranteeing dignified humanitarian rights and human rights for those that are receiving. So in order for everyone not to work on war, what we have to do, if any of the students on Kalu are working in underserved populations or impoverished populations by destitution of their own governments and of their own politics or cultural system, identify these inequities that now can be changed, and do not be blind when you are working in a health facility to those inequities generating health burdens, because those inequities will end up in conflict. And we don't want more conflicts. We want to work to bring dignity and health services to the people in the regular situations. We don't need work to learn anything else.
Thank you, Anna. What about you, Camilo?
Yeah, it's more or less on the, less, the same kind of approach. But basically, I want to point out this, you know, the most powerless people on earth are the refugees and the IDPs. They are dispossessed. They have lost their homes. They have lost their livelihoods. They, in some cases, they have lost whole families. They have lost their friends, their income, their self-esteem. They are powerless. On the other hand, humanitarian workers have a legal authority to provide assistance. They have the financial and organizational resources to do so. They have some, they have technical expertise, and they have education on this type of situations. They have power, basically. They are powerful, the humanitarian workers. And if there's one advice I could give, is be humble. Give voice to the people and involve them in sharing all the decision-making processes they have to do with actions that are, at the end of the day, are going to affect the life of the IDPs and the refugees. Who are we to take decisions for others? How do you feel when someone takes a decision for you without even asking? So think about that. And, you know, on the other hand, as humanitarian workers, we have the technical knowledge, and we can bring in and add to what people have to say, because people also have the knowledge of their situation deeper than anyone else, or what are the problems and what are the solutions that are really realistic and feasible. Yeah. So basically, my being part of these decisions making processes not only brings informed responses, but also brings dignity to the people who have lost all. And I mean, perhaps it doesn't help to advance much in the career, in the humanitarian career, because the way it's set up is not that way, but at least the people with whom you work will really always be appreciative of taking them into account.
Oh my God, Anna and Camilo, it gives me goosebumps. What a powerful advice, and what a powerful closing for this interview. I cannot thank you more for what you shared. It opens definitely our eyes, our minds, and our hearts. Thank you so much, and wishing you great success in these projects. And we wish all the best for all the beneficiaries, the people who are blessed to work with you and to benefit from your hard work. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.